Blog Talk Radio. Noches and greetings to everyone for joining me on my first two-hour Babcha's Pearls Blog Talk Radio Show. Up, music doesn't want to stop. We have that frequently. Okay. I'm Chrissy McMahon, your host on this pleasant Sarasota evening. It's 57 degrees. The moon is waxing at 28% full, and the sun is quiet. I want to start the show by acknowledging the Tucson, Arizona Congresswoman Gabriel Giffert and her critical injuries and the others who were killed. I would like to ask that everyone listening send their healing light and forgiveness to those involved and affected by this tragedy. Only love heals. Thank you all for your continued good intentions, and love is greatly needed, and it works miracles. And I would now like to give you a brief rundown on what I've been following in my last show concerning the mass deaths of the birds, fish, tortoise, crabs, and doves reported on the mainstream media. Continue to suspect poison, although no autopsies have concluded chemical, biological agents are involved, only massive internal injuries. And I recently learned about personal numerology that the year 2011 is a number 4 year. And according to Marcia Bender, Spiritually Speaking column in the new Florida Suncoast Transformations magazine, which is free in the West Florida area, she writes, personal years show how to avoid trouble, direct personal affairs, and get the best from experiences. You can check out her website at metaphysicswithmarcia.com. That's one word, metaphysicswithmarcia.com. And you can check out numerology on that link. And tonight, without further ado, we have a very special guest for this two-hour format. Tonight, my special guest is Andrew Norton Webber, an artist who I met in Vilcabamba, Ecuador, at the 1020 Newtopia 2010 conference, where he discussed distilled liquids and their effect on organic creatures. And tonight, he is going to give a brief presentation about what he's learned about distilled liquids and their effect on our health. And I believe that this information is so important that I'm asking that everybody share this information. I've posted it on my Facebook at Chrissy McMahon at Facebook, and I'm posting all the links that he's sending me here on this link to Blog Talk Radio, Babcha's Pearls, for his archive will be available here anytime to review. So I'm going to ask Andrew now to give us a brief bio about himself, and he can start his conversation whenever he's ready. Andrew, are you there?
Yeah, Chrissy, how you doing?
Hi, I'm going to take you off speaker. Hold on.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Hey, thanks for having me on. Like you, I want to send out this message with love to everybody. My name is Andrew Norton Webber, and I was born in Maine, 1970, and grew up there with a typical Western education. And somewhere along the way, I started making art, and I've continued to do that. And my artworks, found object sculptures, can be viewed at AndrewNortonWebber.com, and Webber is with two B's. I guess we should get right to it. I was responsible for feeding my family 5 or 6 years ago, and somehow started learning about all the poisons that were surrounding us, fluoride in the water and additives in the food, and noticing how decrepit our fellow citizens had become, and noticing that my great-grandparents and grandparents all lived to much older ages with many more of their faculties intact, and just within my own growing up, watch people get more and more decrepit at earlier and earlier ages. And so I started looking into how I could best protect my family from health and feeding them and the right liquids until, of course, water was high on the list.
I think that's an excellent, excellent start. Keep going. I'm sorry to interrupt.
I at first was fooled by most, like most people, away from distilled water. There was a theme out there that it was it would leach minerals from the body, and it was visually, you were given the description that, say, it would leach the calcium out of your bones, and you would fall apart, literally, and crumple to the floor. And there just seemed to be this back-and-forth banter about it, but no real way for me to know whether it was true or not. So I couldn't really take a risk on poisoning my family. And from my study at the time, I thought that mountain spring water was the best that there was, and then spring water was second best, and then, you know, well water below that. And it turns out after much research that it's almost completely the opposite. The more time that water has run through rocks, say all the way through a mountain, the more chance it's had to pick up material that it's actually very largely responsible for a lot of the decay we see, aside from the man-made ingested chemicals like fluoride and aspartame. It turns out that distilled liquids are the only liquids that actually remove things from the body. Pure water has nothing attached to it, has no dirt to it. It's distilled water is water that's been taken apart and reassembled bit by bit. You would think that when you look it up in the dictionary, you'd see steam evaporation as the main definition, but that's only per example. It's any number of ways that water is completely separated at the molecular level, and when it's reassembled, there's just pure hydrogen and oxygen. That's distilled water, and that's it is the greatest solvent known to the human body. And yes, you could pour other solvents on your body and literally dissolve the body, like hydrochloric acid. But that's not what I'm talking about. This particular solvent dissolves everything except you, and it. It makes simple sense once you come back to it that we are water-based creatures and you would use water to clean us up. When you use oil-based cleaners, you use oil-based paints, you use oil-based cleaners. When you use water-based paints, you use water-based creatures. And so this simple answer really comes back to that pure water, which is only one form of it, and that's distilled water, is the solvent that we all need to turn around this massive degeneration that we've witnessed amongst all of our loved ones, and we're all very scared and confused and don't know where to begin, and everything seems scientific, and Western medicine is just full of all these high-tech gadgetry images and gadgets, and you know, they've got urine up on the International Space Station, but you need $1 million machine to turn it into drinkable water. They're always putting out this front that access to high health is only available if you have lots of money and lots of technology. And what I'm going to reveal to you during this talk, hopefully, is that once again, the answers come back to simplicity, and we are supposed to be made perfect, and that's what these answers are pointing to, is that we don't need fancy machines. We are perfect as we are, and all the answers lie within us.
That's a beautiful statement, Andrew, and I think that's a beautiful beginning for this conversation. Before we go any further, I would just like to encourage people, if they have any questions, they can either call in live at 347-637-1832, or they can ask their questions through chat, which is open live now. And I'm switching back and forth so I can keep abreast of anybody who might like to do that. But maybe you need to give them a little bit more information. So I just wanted to encourage people to call in. The number is 347-637-1832. And Andrew loves questions, so don't be bashful. Okay, go ahead, Andrew.
Yeah, your questions help define what I've left out and what people need to know. So please, any questions at any time.
Certainly. Thank you.
Let's kind of start with where we are right now in time. We're all holding our breath. We've got this 2012 drumbeat over our heads, and the main media just pumps out nothing but fear about it. And I found in my studies that whatever they're promoting, you generally should run in the opposite direction, and whatever they're telling you to stay away from is usually some of the best things that there are. And so that, just for one thing, makes me actually optimistic towards 2012, and life has been full of more and more coincidental happenings lately that encourage that for myself on a whole personal level. We're at this, the age of Aquarius is supposed to be upon us, and supposed to be the end of the age of Pisces. And there's a lot of talk that this is the lowest point on the great year, the lowest point of our mental awareness, of our vibrational state. And I find it interesting that Aquarius, the water bearer, is who shows up at this time on the wheel, because what better way to start off a rise towards a new Atlantis, or whatever it may turn out to be, than a good cleanup job. And that is exactly what the information of pure water is going to do for us. This seems to be just, you know, almost everywhere you look, it's a nightmare of people and messages and the shape that people in and the mentality of people. And people are very disconcerted and confused and disoriented. And something as simple as pure water is going to be where we need to start. So I appreciate Aquarius showing up. I think the age of Pisces is finally over, and let us rejoice in the age of Aquarius, a new beginning and a new chance to create the new dimension. There's also talk that water is the lubricant between dimensions. I don't know if you ever heard that before. And that
no,
also
I don't think I have.
Yeah, I heard Leonard Horowitz talking about that, and I've seen it a couple of other places. And that rang with me as well, again, about this Pisces-Aquarius split, because this is supposed to be a time when we make a shift to a new dimension or a new vibrational rate. And what do we have showing up? Water. And water is the lubricant between dimensions. So here we go. Whether it's all just coincidental or not, it makes for good poetry.
Yeah.
So we'll go with that.
And it's, you're speaking so eloquently. I'm just so honored. This is amazing. But wait till you get to the real meat of what you're trying to say here. This is just absolutely wonderful. Thank you, Andrew. I'm very honored that you're taking the time to share this with us. So I don't want to keep interrupting, but I'm just in awe. Go ahead. Thank you.
And thank you too for you filmed this me down in Ecuador, and you are likewise having the courage to speak out and put this out there, and it's resonating with you, and so it's making you feel comfortable. It's resonating with me, so it's making me feel comfortable to speak, and I hope everybody else can feel this as we relay this information.
Yes, I believe there's an opening for this now. People are very interested. We have about 10 people on chat, so I'm pretty excited. I hope they'll have the courage, too, to ask questions.
Okay.
So,
let's get right to where people can get distilled water. And how it works. So give the proof for it as well. There's four main types of distilled water. There's machine-made distilled water, all fruit and vegetable juices, urine, and rainwater. The second half of a rainstorm, it's all distilled water, but the first half generally clears the skies and it becomes undistilled by the time it falls. And the second half is distilled water, although I'm not sure with the chemtrails now what state it's in when it finally reaches the ground. So that's where you can get them, but let me more define distill. It took me a while to figure out what they were talking about, and if you put the link up to Dr. Handley's paper on your radio page there, he made the point about that distilled water is the most molecularly unstable water there is. And when he said that, it finally clicked for me what distilled means. It's unstilled, meaning it used to be still, and now it's not still. And so when I say it's the fastest water there is, I'm kind of relating it to surface tension. And like the Dead Sea, you can float, it's so full of other objects besides hydrogen and oxygen, you can float a concrete canoe on it. And so it has incredibly high surface tension. I think distilled water probably has the lowest surface tension. And that's what they mean by it's molecularly unstable. It doesn't have all these different little particles attached to it. And so when you drink it into your body, it goes everywhere with no resistance, because there's no little parts to it making it scratchier and slow down and have a lot of texture and friction. And you'll find that if you haven't ever drank distilled water, if you quickly put down a pound of it, 16 ounces, you'll feel something akin to a hot flash or some internal heat, or some people feel literally a bead of sweat on their back and front. And we all know that when we sweat, that's a detox reaction. And what that is showing you is how fast that this water cuts through you. So I'll get back to more about the hot flash later. People have to know whether or not they can drink it, first of all, because when you do look it up, you'll run into the same thing that fooled me 5 or 6 years ago, which is, oh gosh, it might leach minerals from the body. Well, this is an on-purpose fake science campaign to keep you away from it because it's so simple. And this knowledge is worth trillions of dollars and massive amounts of power if you keep it away from people. And so there are these incomplete arguments out there, like the WHO, if you look up them in distilled water, and even most people, when you ask them what do they know about distilled water, they'll generally say, oh, no, don't, because it'll leach minerals from the body. And where they're largely getting that from is the WHO's paper that says plainly, do not drink distilled water because it will leach minerals from the body. And a couple of sentences later, they throw in, and by the way, you should add fluoride to your water as well. So if anybody is hip to how poisonous sodium fluoride is, you know where that paper is coming from. It doesn't make sense. It's who would recommend fluoride you should be suspicious of them telling you not to drink distilled water. But still, you don't have any proof. It just says that. And what they're leaving out is that it's scientifically known that there's two types of minerals. There's organic and inorganic. And so when they just say, don't drink it because it leaches minerals from the body, they're forgetting to clarify what types of minerals they're talking about. And you might say, oh, maybe they're talking about both minerals. Well, there is proof for that, and there is a proof to forever put that question to rest. Let me just state it, first of all, though, that distilled water only leaches inorganic minerals from the body. And this is a scientifically known fact. In this supposedly great scientific body, the World Health Organization, that's supposed to be the pinnacle of watching out for our health, somehow overlooks the fact that they need to distinguish what minerals it actually leaches from the body. Because, yes, you can say, yes, it's true, it does leach minerals from the body, but only inorganic ones should be added to that sentence. It does not leach organic minerals. And what's the purpose of that distinction? Very, very big purpose for that distinction is that the human body is only made out of organic minerals. There is zero position and or zero use for inorganic minerals in the body. So sodium fluoride, just for starters, is an inorganic mineral. What's it doing in our drinking water, let alone how poison it is? Just the fact that it's inorganic says that it has no use to the body. The body does not create life out of dead matter. The body only uses life to create more life. And so I am in a rare position to have the proof to argue about distilled water because of having studied the whole world of urine therapy for 5 years. That was something I learned early on. A yogi that I was talking to, I was peppering him like a human Google machine, trying to figure out how to save my family, asking about everything, the herbs, the gems, and raw food, and on and on and on. And I was out of questions. And at the end of it, he finally goes, you know, you can drink your urine and cure just about anything. And I was like, what? And he goes, yeah, look up urine therapy. And that term right there, if anybody wants to start their own search, that's what you punch into either Amazon or Google. And it's all right there. But if you never know to search for it, you'll never find it. I have personally collected from all over the planet over 20 books on urine therapy. And they're from Australia, Germany, India, England, America. I know there's Japanese and Asian books. I just have never bought one. But they're all very small. And because the instructions are pretty simple. You drink it fresh, and only when it's fresh, and you bathe in it once a day. And if you're really sick and you're trying to reverse any disease, you go on a fast of just urine. And what you start to notice over and over again when you read all these case studies, and I've personally read and learned about over 1,000 of them. Each book might contain about 50 of them, but then there's just, you know, the numerous people I've talked to over the years, my own experiences, other people have tried it because I told them to, and they report back to me what happened. Without fail, over and over and over again, when people go on a 20 or 30-day urine fast, they lose 20 to 30 years of appearance. Not only do they vaporize cancer, tuberculosis, AIDS, leprosy, whatever you want to name it, it vaporizes that, but then reverses the body's age. And urine, like I said, is one of the four sources of distilled water. It is a well-known fact that urine is 95% water, and it's not just any kind of water, it's distilled water. And so the entire world of case histories of urine therapy can be used to prove to people that distilled water only leaches inorganic minerals from the body. A couple of very strong cases in point are arthritis and the whitening of the teeth. It is well known and documented throughout all these books that the application of urine compacts or compresses and or massages on the skin and combined with drinking it melts arthritis. And the same thing when people swish for 10 minutes at a time with urine, in a pretty quick amount of time, very shortly, their teeth start turning white. And you will see this over and over and over again in all the urine therapy books. And when I first read that, I was like, wow, that's phenomenal. I can't believe it. And I can't believe it because I'm also witnessing it in my fellow friends and in my own teeth. I'm an artist, so I know what color looks like. And I've watched my teeth go from kind of yellow to less yellow. And they get whiter by the day. None of the books that I had, part of what we're talking about here is a kind of a revelation that I've had from putting all these bodies of information together. None of them explained how urine was doing these amazing things. But yet you knew it was because there were so many testimonials from all over the planet, and you see it in your own experiments. And the most I could figure out, even over 5 years, I think it's why I bought 20 books, is I kept trying to figure out how. And as I tried to tell people about it, they kept asking me, yeah, but why, how, isn't the waste product, on. And it really forced me to come up with answers if I was going to actually try to tell people about it.
Yeah, Andrew, before you get into the how, I would really like you to talk more about the gestation part. I think it's real important for people to understand that how we start life. And there's a couple other things. If you could explain that. And maybe that will help people understand. We have this cultural, like, repulsion to any talk about urine as anything besides a waste product.
Gotcha.
And maybe you can get more into the mechanics of how that works, too, before you, you know, tell them,
or
like, how to use it.
Do
you understand? Because I think I know that I've come up against the same resistance with people when I've tried to talk to them about the importance of urine therapy and how beneficial it is. But, you know, sometimes I guess I lead with the foot. I tell them the end of the story and don't tell them the beginning of it. And I think it might help culturally to understand where we come from. You know, how do we start our lives, and how that the mechanics of the distillation process, how that works.
Okay. Just to make sure you prompt me to come back to the teeth, because that's the proof of and arthritis.
Certainly.
But, yeah, you're right. Explain it. We've actually all floated in urine for 9 months. We'll help people to understand where this is coming from.
Mm-hmm.
What you're referring to, the beginning of life, is the amniotic fluid is 95% urine, I don't know, 5% goo. But for the most part, for the first 3 months, it's your mom's urine, and for the remaining 6 months, it's your urine. And I use this to not only help people see that it creates life, but that it's also not a waste product. Because if it were a waste product, how is it possible that a fetus, even a zygote, from day one is floating in urine? And if it was a waste product, we wouldn't be growing in it for much more than a couple of days. This is why they say that the water breaks, and urine is in truth is known as the water of life. And anywhere you see it in the Bible where they're talking about rivers of living water or the water of life, if you read that understanding that they're talking about urine, the statements make a lot more sense, and you understand that's why it is. And this is why babies and angels are always peeing into fountains, because it is that very pee that you pee out while you're inside your mother that grows yourself. People keep coming back to, yeah, but isn't urine a waste product? And look at the baby. Look at where the waste cord is attached to the baby, the umbilical cord, is attached to the intestines. Is there an umbilical cord covering your genitals and capturing your pee? No, it's your pee that's actually creating the water that breaks, the water of life. If you were going to grow a human in a floating solution, I would think the liquid you would be on top of your list to choose would be one called the water of life. And we breathe it in. We float in it for 9 months. That's why babies have such awesome plump skin when we come out, because they've been floating in urine for 9 months. And it's supermodel's biggest secret, that they put fresh urine on their face at night and then wash it off in the morning. It makes the skin super soft and supple. And as you're floating in mom, we breathe like a fish at that point, if you all remember. And what is it that you're breathing in? You're breathing in urine. And without it, our lungs would not form. It's basically the ultimate human growth medium. And whatever you touch it to restores it to its original genetic DNA instructions.
That's perfect. And then the mechanics of how urine, the distillation product process in our bodies, how that the nephrons that you talked about in the video that I have, maybe you could explain that. I think that's really important, because I actually checked, because I was trying to find the words, but I went and I researched what you were talking about, and the picture, if you can go online and Google it, and see the picture of what a nephron is. Maybe you can explain how the kidney works and the plasma and all that. You know, I think that's real important. That's the part I left out when I talked about it the other day, because I think that's so important to say, where does urine really come from? What's the mechanics of it?
Okay.
You know, we can tout the benefits and how to use it, but really, we really need to understand so we can get that mental picture of it being a waste product into what it actually is. You need to understand where it comes from and what it actually is.
So one, we've got the baby floating in, so that helps to argue against it being a waste product, and we form in it. The mechanics of it more to help you understand it's not a waste product. The overall misconception that people have is that the liver handles solid waste and the kidneys handle liquid waste. And it's absolutely not true. The liver handles all waste. And when blood leaves the liver, it is completely clean and needs no more cleaning. When the blood enters the kidneys, even CRC Publishing is a very well-respected scientific journal. Their book on urinalysis states that blood leaving the kidney is only very slightly altered compared to blood entering the kidney. And so if those were cleaners, it would be greatly altered, not only very slightly altered. And it looks like there's a couple of basic functions to the kidneys rather than being cleaners and blood filters. One is pressure release, and that's the most that I'll allow people to argue that it's a waste product. Say like when you drink a lot of beer, you start having to pee a lot. Well, your kidneys are responsible literally for your internal blood pressure. And so when you got too much liquid in there, it has to release it. The other one is your pH balance. Like a medicine chest, your kidneys are pulling out and removing and inserting back into the blood to make it the proper pH balance for what you need at that time. And as far as the nephrons, when I referred to the dictionary and distillation, and you might think it says steam evaporation, but no, that's only per example. What it really says is bit by bit. And that's, I say that because you know that there's no steam evaporators inside your kidneys.
Right.
And so that is another example of distillation. The water is being distilled. It's being made to flow as smoothly as possible. There are a million nephrons inside each kidney, and when you look at an individual nephron, it's got this set of loops in it, which are called the distal tubules, distillation tubes, and every nephron has one of those. So inside your body, you have 2 million distillation tubes, and they are squeezing the water finer and finer and finer, and the end of each nephron comes down to, people generally think that their kidneys are solid, but there's actually a cave, a chamber, in the middle of each kidney. And kind of like water weeps through the inside wall of a cave, that mm-hmm. interior chamber in the middle of your kidney, brand new, what eventually is called urine, weeps from that wall. And that is where that water is coming back together bit by bit. And from there, from the bottom of each one of those two chambers, there's a tube which leads to the bladder. And so your body is actually distilling water. And it's how your body is the only water that your body uses. So that should tip you off, too. And what am I talking about? I'm talking about that your blood is 90% water. And it's, again, not just any kind of water. Just like the amniotic fluid is 95% water. It's not just any kind of water. It's distilled water. The blood is not just any kind of water. It's distilled water. And that is probably the main reason that your body is, the kidneys are there, is to run distilled water through the veins. And what's the purpose of that? We come back to the fact that distilled water leaches inorganic minerals from the body. Inorganic minerals are things like grease and stuff that's dead, and tar and fat and butter. And I always used to wonder to myself, when I was washing my hands after cooking, when you had grease or Crisco on them, it takes forever to get that slippery feeling off, even with hot water and soap. And I always used to wonder, gosh, I'm eating all these Pringles and Big Macs, and I've had steaks and lobster drenched in butter. And I know there's no hot water and there's no scrubbers inside my body. I was like, how is my body doing that? And when I finally started looking into distilled water, that's how it does it. The inorganic mineral breakup powers of distilled water is what keeps the blood flowing and liquid. And without it, we would seize up, you know, real quickly. And you know, well, okay, but people are getting older and dying anyways. But it's because we're taking in garbage at a rate faster than which the body can expel it. That is another simple equation for good health, is to take in garbage at a rate that's slower than the rate at which your body can expel it. And then you start to reverse the trend, and the body actually is always doing whatever it can to eject garbage. And distilled water is your body's number one source to keep you alive. Your bloodstream is the last bastion of safety. If it does not keep that highway moving, that's when you seize up and you die. And it's distilled water that's just pumping in and out of your heart all the time. And I think that's pretty good proof for the mechanics of it.
Yes, that's awesome. did you want to go back to talking about how to use distilled liquids, or maybe talk about alternatives to urine therapy, and how, like you talked about, the different types of water, spring water, mountain water, well water, and maybe like to compare different types of distilled liquids to urine therapy.
Okay. I think I should bring back the proof through arthritis and the whitening of the teeth.
Yes, yes.
When I just myself learned about distilled liquids about 7 or 8 months ago. Up until that time, I was still fooled and thought that mountain spring water is the best. And here at my house, we dug a well to get rid of fluoride, and we were drinking well water. And I read a book by a man named Hilton Hotema, H-O-T-E-M-A. And he has many books, but one called Man's Higher Consciousness. And Hilton Hotema spent his life, or at least 30 years of it, traveling the world, going to the sites of all the ancient mystery schools, and gathering and piecing together what information he could. And his, for anybody who's searching, his books are full of a wealth of information. And he had this one chapter about distilled water, and I thought I already knew about distilled water, but I said, well, all right, I'll read it anyways. And at this time, I had a complete library of knowledge in my head about what urine does to people and urine therapy and over 1,000 case histories. I was very well versed in it. And he started listing what he said that distilled water does to the body. And it very quickly, my mind picked up that everything he was listing was one of the things that urine does. I was like, wait, that's what urine does. That's what urine does. That's what urine does. And then this light came on that reminded me that there is this one little line in all the urine therapy books about distilled water, that it's a scientific baseline. They always say urine is more sterile than distilled water. That's their way of kind of letting you know how pure and sterile urine is. And even the science books, they say the exact same thing. It's more sterile than machine-made water. And so when this guy started listing, he says, Hilton Hotema said, distilled water dissolves mineral deposits. I said, wait a second. I said, all the books say that urine is more pure than distilled water, and all the urine books also say things like urine dissolves rocks and melts stones. And when Hilton Hotema said that distilled water dissolves mineral deposits, I said, hey, that's the same line. And then the light came on, because of all the times I've seen that urine is more sterile than distilled water, that it's the distilled water aspect of urine that is melting arthritis, that is whitening the teeth. Again, none of the books described how it was doing it, and the most I could figure on my own was, okay, maybe it's the ammonia content of urine or the astringent properties of it. Somehow it's cleaning things. But then when I saw Hilton say that, and I got the WHO, who is a known entity against good health, telling us not to drink distilled water, and I put that together with that I've seen urine melt arthritis and cataracts and turn teeth whiter, it finally dawned on me that this is the proof that distilled water only leaches inorganic minerals from the body, because if it was leaching both, people's teeth wouldn't just get white, they'd start to dissolve. Mm-hmm. And that doesn't happen. People just become healthier and stronger than ever when they either cycle distilled liquids or urine through their body. And so I just throw that out to people. Go look at urine therapy yourself. And it doesn't necessarily mean that you've got to try it, but use it as a piece of evidence to help educate yourself. Because if you don't know this, you have to take a chance on whether or not distilled water is going to leach minerals for you. From you and kill you, you know, aside from your bones breaking apart, they give you the other idea, like it's going to leach all the potassium from you and you're going to have a heart attack, or, you know, they just come out all different ways to scare you away from it.
Right.
And the whole case history of urine therapy proves it. And so the knowledge of distilled water was a gift to me after 5 years of trying to convince people, look, just drink your urine, you know. Of course, it doesn't go over very well. Mm-hmm. And so now I can come here on this radio show and at the age of Aquarius and tell you that it's not just urine. It's distilled liquids. It's perfect water for these water-based creatures that we perfectly are, that is going to be the beginning of cleansing us out, of reversing all the genetic degeneration. Water contains the memory of who we are and of everything that the universe is. And you start cycling pure water through you, whether it's machine-made or fruit juices or urine or rainwater, this is the beginning. This is the knowledge that we're all looking for, and it's within everybody's grasp. You don't need big, expensive machines. You don't need giant hospitals. This puts the information right in front of us to cure ourselves. You can go on, if you just want to take in coconut water, that's a distilled liquid. Orange juice. One of my case studies I read was about a girl who didn't even know anything about urine. It wasn't even part of the case study. She drank nothing but fresh squeezed orange juice for 6 months. Nothing but. And she was overweight, she was sickly, she was depressed, her skin looked terrible. And after 6 months on pure orange juice, she had complete rejuvenation, complete removal of all those symptoms, and lost years in appearance and felt better than she ever had.
Mm-hmm.
And so let me say this at this point, just in case people are seeing that up close to it. This is the Fountain of Youth. The joke about the Fountain of Youth being the lost Fountain of Youth is that it makes you think, oh, if I could only find it over that mountain over somewhere, it's somewhere, I know it, and if I could just find it, I could have my health and live a long time without decrepitness. The Fountain of Youth is your genitals. If you look at images of fountain, it's always a spout that's spouting water. And your bladder is the pool that the fountain draws from. And this explains, again, come back to the cherubs always peeing in the fountain. That's exactly what that's symbolizing. It's the water of life. It's the Fountain of Youth. And we all have it with us wherever we are. And the knowledge of distilled water is a gift because it means it's not just urine, because we've been so programmed against it, even for the most highest vibrating people that might be listening to this or be told about it. We have been brainwashed so hard, it is very hard to do it.
Mm-hmm.
But distilled water and or fruit juice and or rainwater are three options that will have the same or almost the same effect on you. As urine.
I'm not sure if I would promote rainwater, but
right,
I know that the process, the natural process of natural rain, not induced or manipulated rain, has the distilled water effects. But the rain that is falling, consequently, all over the earth, I don't think there's a place on earth that isn't impacted by chemtrails and weather modifications. So I would not recommend rainwater. That would not be something I would encourage people to drink. Although we're drinking water out of the tap, which is full of fluoride and other medications and stuff that people are flushing down the toilet, but that's another topic maybe for another discussion,
on Dr. Handley's paper that I mentioned, mm-hmm. the other important part of his paper is that he looks at a study done in the 1800s or based on the 1800s that when people used to drink rainwater and then made the switch to city waters or tap waters, there was a direct correlation between people getting off of rainwater and the rise of heart attacks.
Wow.
So when people were on distilled water, that distilled water, on rainwater, when they were living in rural areas and they were catching up their roofs, when that was their main source of water back when the skies were clear, that distilled water was keeping their hearts free-flowing. And mm-hmm. as people got off of distilled water and got into this terrible, slow, still water, they started having the heart attack rates just shot up in direct correlation.
That's amazing. That's real important. These facts that you're coming up with, it all can be researched and it all can be proven. So I think that's like the biggest argument is that there are correlations that prove historically the damaging effect of the waters that we drink that's processed through our civic water systems and the fluoride that's added and just what they're doing with the modification of rain and everything is just the increase of all the health problems that we've had, even in just the last 20 years. The health effects that have been detrimental and the increase in all kinds of problems just show.
I think the rainwater thing to segue into the important other fact that people need to know. Everybody's aware of the symbiotic relationship that we have with plants as far as oxygen, carbon dioxide exchange. But most people are unaware that there's another one that works, has the same pattern of that's what we use and they don't use. And it's, again, comes back to minerals. Plants only ingest inorganic minerals. Humans live off of and should only ingest organic minerals. And humans exit inorganic minerals. Plants take in inorganic minerals and they exit organic minerals. So what do you mean they exit? Well, I'm talking about the actual, the body of the plant and the fruit of the plant. An important part of that rainwater being distilled water and how it works with the plants is, like Hilton Hotama says, distilled water dissolves mineral deposits. And that's what stones and rocks are. They're giant globs of inorganic mineral deposits. And when rain falls down, rain, as a distilled liquid, literally melts rocks and stones. And that's what plants live off of. They take inorganic minerals up through their roots and through, I don't know if it's transmutation or osmosis, what the correct term is, they do a wonderful thing for us. They turn inorganic matter into organic matter. There's two forms of every mineral, like I said, even, say, calcium. In rocks, in stones, and in mountain spring water, and in all these fancy bottled waters, when they list, you know, that it's got calcium in it, they all fail to mention that it's inorganic calcium.
Mm-hmm.
And plants live on inorganic calcium. And when a plant produces an orange, they have turned that inorganic calcium into organic calcium. And that's a nice little thing that they do for us because it's what we need to live on. And that's where the whole raw food movement is. You could boil it down to, well, boil is the wrong term, but they're trying to get people to not turn their live food, their organic food, and I don't mean organic as in the style of farming, just the fact that it's alive, when you cook it, you turn it into inorganic matter. And so
that's by destroying all the enzymes and the nutrients that are present in the fresh live food,
and literally turning it into stuff that the body can't use.
Right.
And so the inorganic calcium that's in expensive bottled waters, or that's in the rocks, that will create arthritis. That will freeze you up. That will get stuck in your lenses. That will give you cataracts. That will give you arteriosclerosis. But the calcium that's in an orange, the organic calcium, will repair a spot in your bones. And that's the big difference, is we want organic minerals. That's it on plants.
And that brings us, I think, to our first hour. We have about 5 minutes left in the second hour starting. And I'll give the call-in number again. It's 347-637-1832. And the lines are open and the chat is open. And I know this is a really difficult topic for a lot of people, so I understand the anticipation and the resistance to even accepting this information. And I just want to thank Andrew again for being so diligent and really knowing on a historical and scientific basis what he's talking about. And maybe you could even share with us a little bit about the history of urine therapy, like how ancient this practice is, how long that this has been used. It's been used, in, I believe, in India, maybe in other countries I'm not aware of, and how it's evolved through the ages. Maybe you could give us some short history lesson on urine therapy.
Okay. And anybody can look these up themselves. You'll find all the same stuff I do. The two of the oldest documents I know of is there's an Egyptian papyrus called the Water of Life, and it's at least 6,000 years old. And it's only 10 verses, but it's basically telling you that the first one says to bathe with it and drink it. And one of the most telling lines for me that I found most appealing, especially for where we are in this time, is out of 10 sentences about it, one of them was devoted to that the water of life will open and reveal the hidden senses.
Mm-hmm.
And that immediately spoke to me that, you know, obviously he's talking about more than just the five senses. And that, for me, gets into the pineal gland and our third eye. And we can talk about that in a second, too. And the other ancient document is from India, and that one's 5,000 years old. It's called the Shivambhu Kalpa. And Shivambhu is spelled S-H-I-V-A-M-B-U. It refers to the god Shiva, or the water of Shiva. It's also known as the water of auspiciousness. And I find it fitting that it's in India, the word for urine is Shivambhu, because Shiva is, they call Shiva the creator, and they also call Shiva the destroyer.
Mm-hmm.
And that seems to be what urine does for people, is it destroys everything that is not you, and it helps to create everything that is you and everything that you want yourself to be. Shiva protects you. And that document is inside of a larger document called the Damar Tantra. And the Shivambhu Kalpa inside that is 107 verses specifically devoted to how to use urine. And if we were supposedly cavemen 5,000 or 6,000 years ago, I was kind of confused as to how we had these specific instructions of how to use urine way back then. Another oddity to that document is after 106 verses of telling you about this amazing thing that you've got this own product with you all the time to do all these wonderful things with, the last one is it says, but don't tell anyone, keep it a secret. And the whole document is laid out in the form of the god Shiva talking to his wife Parvati. And the last thing he says to Parvati is, he goes, but don't tell anyone, it's a secret. So I'm actually suspicious that that is an ancient Illuminati, so to speak, document, or, you know, the people who kept the knowledge, because the last thing they do is they don't tell anybody, which is kind of, it's not very nice.
Well, yeah, there's a lot of esoteric undercurrents in the things that you're talking about. It's just, it's uncanny that nobody really understands about this knowledge, and it's hidden in plain sight. You know, we have the fountains with the little boy peeing or the cherubs peeing into the fountain, and the Bible verses telling us to drink from our own cistern, but we don't really understand even what we're looking at or what we're hearing. We think it's some, you know, special water from God, or, you know, God's going to anoint us with something that we can't comprehend. And when it all comes down to, you know, it's all coming from inside. You know, I went to meet with my group yesterday, and one of the things that just came out, I didn't even think about it before I said it, but at this time we're supposed to go inward. We're supposed to listen to our own selves and not, like, seek out a guru or, you know, go to climb a mountain and try to find this mystical person to tell you what you're supposed to do, but go inward and seek within ourselves what the truth is. And then it hit me while I'm promoting, you know, your talk and your information, that I'm saying, you know, in the same breath, you know, this is something that's coming from inside of us. It's our own urine. And that's what we keep hearing. I was like, the message is being given to us, but we're not hearing it. We're not seeing it. We're not understanding it because we haven't been given the information that we need to decode it. It's like a secret code. And maybe, I don't know. I don't understand why everybody shouldn't have the knowledge, except for, you know, what is said, that this is a slave race, and it's only meant for the aristocracy or the slave owners, or however you want to say it. But I don't want it to be a derogatory or negative slant on the conversation. I want to say that this is the great revealing with Pluto and all these other things, Shiva, you know, destroying the blocks, the things that are blocking us from having the truth. And the truth is being revealed to us because now we're ready to hear it, or, you know, now we need to hear it. So this is beautiful. I just think this is wonderful, and I hope the people who are listening can appreciate the value of what you're sharing with them, because this is knowledge that even on a materialistic, mechanistic level that most people live in our society, I don't have the fear. When I left Vilcabamba, I no longer had the fear after your talk of what was going to happen when food ran out or people were rioting in the streets or whatever that they think that's going to happen at 2012 or beyond, that I knew when I was in the midst of our conference that I was going to be safe and that I had a way to keep my family safe. And to share, and I had something that I had to share with other people. So that maybe that's, you know, why I got this 2-hour special. So I don't really want to talk. I really want to hear you talk because you're so eloquent and everything you're saying is so important. So I'll just keep promoting you and encouraging you because I love this stuff. This is awesome. Thank you so much, Andrew.
Yeah, yeah, it feels very timely. I also find another funny correlation that Aquarius the water bearer is shown as bearing a pitcher of water, and Shiva, too, is the main image of him, is he's always holding a golden bowl. And I always wondered what that was, but now I know it's in the bowl. And I find it funny that these two water gods are coming back at this exact point in time when we could use a cleanup.
Mm-hmm.
For those who are frustrated with a calcified pineal gland, I know as I research fluoride, I cringed when I saw those Nazi scientists saying, you let me put a man on fluoride for 1 year and he'll never be the same.
Mm.
And for a while, that was my biggest nemesis. I was like, how am I going to get around that? Because I suffered the effects of fluoride poisoning myself, had a lot of ADD symptoms my whole life, had... You know, middle-class family, I had all the advantages. I should have had great grades, but I just couldn't study or concentrate. And I always knew it wasn't my fault because I wasn't trying to do it. It just was, like, very uncomfortable to focus to the point it felt like drudgery. And so I would always rather play with the pencil sharpener on my desk than try to put all these sentences and words together. My mind kept getting distracted. And... I think it'll help people to know that fluoride rips apart your DNA. The double-twisted helix shape of your DNA, that little ladder rung going up there, those are hydrogen bonds. And fluoride literally dissolves the hydrogen bonds, and your double-twisted helix shape unravels and untwists. And that same coiled shape, when you take apart any radio, the antenna, the wires are wrapped in that same double-twisted helix shape, and every piece of DNA, which is inside every cell you have, is literally a radio antenna transmitter receiver, and that's what's broadcasting your aura, And when you hear a good piece of news and you feel this rush of elation, you feel it ripple through your body, it's that signal being broadcast from one piece of DNA to another. And when you hear a bad piece of news and you feel low, that same information is traveling across all those radio bands. And so that's how your thoughts and your actions largely communicate across your whole sense of oneness. And when you have ADD, those signals or thoughts that were supposed to be traveling up that radio antenna, well, if the antenna is unraveled halfway up it, those thoughts get shot out to the side. And as you were traveling to the workshop room with the tape measure in your hand, you were going to go do something, you might get to the workshop room and have no clue of why you're there or what you're going to do because you forgot it halfway along the way. And people think you're lazy or stupid or, you know, just a retard. And I would say the derogatory way of saying what fluoride does to people is it makes them lazy. But a more succinct way of saying it is that it diminishes their desire to fight for their life. And that's why fluoride is in there.
That's evident.
Yeah. And
that's a succinct statement, what you just said. That just signifies everything that's going on, why people are not doing anything, or they appear not to be doing anything besides they're overwhelmed trying to live their life. They can't.
Yeah.
They can't fight for themselves, stand up for themselves.
Right. And when you see if people don't want to look up sodium fluoride, I'm sure most people listening know about this, but for those that don't, look up Nazi history and you'll immediately see that it was in the forefront of their plans. They used sodium fluoride in the gulags and the concentration camps and the ghettos because it makes it easy to kill people. And when you see the videos of people marching into the ovens to go get burned, they've all got their heads down and they're marching orderly. I know that if you or I were in a camp and they were marching towards the oven, we'd be rattling the cages. But what you were watching in those videos is super fluoridated people. They put it, you know, they put it in our water at one part per million, but they put it in that water at much higher parts because they really wanted to clamp those people down.
Yeah, but it doesn't matter today because it's in the water, and then the water gets sprayed onto the produce and watered the animals, and it's so concentrated because it's in everything. There isn't anything that fluoride isn't in today. It's not just in our water. It's in everything.
Except for distilled liquids.
Distilled liquid, yes. Yay.
And another thing about fluoride is it purposefully, coming back to the pineal gland, it targets the pineal gland. When they do autopsies on people in fluoridated countries, they have fluoride in most parts of their body at about 5 to 10 parts per million. But when they get to the pineal gland, it's 22,000 parts per million.
Mm-hmm.
And it goes there like a magnet. And it seems like fluoride goes to your most perfect, delicate tissues, and that seems to be your most numero primo, delicate piece of tissue is that third eye, the pineal gland, and it's obvious to me that it's not by accident that that's where it goes, because that's your connection to God or whatever you want to call it. That's your satellite dish to the all. And so when you shut off people's connection to their higher self, to their soul, to their intuition, to their inner voice, that's when you get the effect of it diminishes your desire to fight for your life. And people don't hardly have any fashion sense. You know, you can pick Americans out of a crowd anywhere in places that aren't fluoridated because they've got style, and Americans can't hear their own inner voice of what looks good. They can't make choices about art. They can't design their homes nicely. And so they also, that's all you see these shows on TV about hoarders. They can't make decisions. It's all, we're just watching this completely degenerated world from fluoride. You know, there's a number of things on the list, like MSG and high fructose corn syrup and stuff, and aspartame, but fluoride would be like a bright, shining neon light at the top of the list as to what's causing all these problems. In laboratories, when you give rats high doses of fluoride, within three generations, they start giving birth to crippled rats. And so we've had fluoride for 60 years through more generations than that, but at smaller amounts. And what you are witnessing is the slow ripping apart of our DNA, and parents with ripped DNA giving birth to children with even more ripped DNA, and on and on. And that's what's responsible for the slightly retarded look that we see on a lot of our fellow compatriots and friends. And people are all high and mighty about themselves, like to look at these people and go, ah, they're just degenerates, and I've got good genes. And, well, you know, there may be a little bit to it. Also, maybe that you happen to be luckier and got healthier food and it didn't have as much fluoride in it. And people that are poor are eating all the lowest foods that there are, and they're just getting jammed with it.
Mm-hmm.
And so distilled water comes into this issue as a wonderful savior, because a calcified pineal gland is an inorganic mineral deposit. And what dissolves inorganic mineral deposits but distilled water?
Mm-hmm.
And for everybody out there that's having a hard time meditating, I can relate to that so well. You just, that's such a common thing. I've been meditating for 10 years, but I still can't get anywhere. It's hard for me to keep my thoughts still. Well, that's because your whole body is corrupted and destroyed by fluoride and all these poisons. And distilled water, bit by bit, is going to remove all of that stuff. And when you give the body a chance, it takes great advantage, and it will clean out, and it will regenerate. It is always trying to restore itself to the genetic instructions in our DNA. And when you give it the chance, it will reverse all, it'll throw out all the garbage and reverse all the damage. And that is, you can get more confidence in that if you study urine therapy and just seeing that over and over and over again. That's what happens to people. And when you see that the books from all over the planet, you either got to think, okay, all of these people are lying from all over the planet, or it's true. And you start to lean towards it's true when you experiment yourself. My own personal experiment is everything that I've ever tried on myself works exactly the way the urine therapy books say it will. So you start to see that pattern, that starts to give you proof positive too. How to drink distilled water. Dr. Handley gives a rough formula of you take half your body weight in ounces and drink that every day. And I think that might be fine once you are completely cleaned out. But what I'm seeing for almost all of us who want to get our pineal decalcified, they actually want a functioning third eye, they want to get rid of obesity, you need to drink a gallon a day. And there's a little trick. And I mentioned the hot flash earlier and drinking a pound of it. What I'd recommend to anybody that wants to clean out is to drink a gallon a day, but not just sipping it nilly-willy along throughout the day. Land a pound of it on an empty stomach, roughly, which is 16 ounces, 2 cups, a half a liter is also is 473 milliliters is 16 ounces, but roughly half a liter or 16 ounces, if you throw that down really quickly on an empty stomach, that is how you experience the hot flash or internal heating. And 8 times 16 is 128. And so if you do that 8 times a day, you'll put down a gallon a day. And it's just a convenient little math thing. It doesn't really matter if it's a full gallon or almost a gallon. But 7 or 8 times a day, get it down quickly. You know, if you drink half of it, take a 5-second breather and get the other half down. The important thing is to create the correct internal pressure. You throw that pure water down there on an empty stomach, and it slices through everything that's not you. And you can experience that when you, if you feel the internal heat or the hot flash. A way to do it is you have to get started early, right when you wake up. Throw down a pound of it. So I use the term pound to pound. So I mean, pound it like you're trying to pound a beer or something. Chug it. Get it down quickly. Right when you wake up, 10 minutes before breakfast, halfway in between breakfast and lunch, 10 minutes before lunch, halfway in between lunch and dinner, 10 minutes before dinner, and then halfway in between dinner and bed, and then right before bed. If you do that, that's roughly 7 or 8 times a day. And the importance of throwing it down on an empty stomach is if there's all this food in there you've just eaten, it's going to hit that food and work on that first. But if your stomach is empty, it's going to go down there and bam, and literally put a shoulder of force. If you drink a pound, it's going to put a pound of internal pressure against everything that's not you, all the acids and inorganic minerals and crystals in your body. It's going to put force pressure on those, and that's what's going to create the internal heat and or literally a bead of sweat on your chest and down your back. If you don't feel it at first, keep trying it. It found it's different for different people when they actually start to feel it affecting them that way.
And, okay. I think it's real important for people to understand the uses of it, but maybe explain why it's so difficult to get past the smell of it. Like, how can somebody just, like, go today? And why would it be difficult for them to just go, like, after this interview and try to even drink a drop of their urine? Why, you know, maybe you could talk a little bit.
At that point, to just machine-made distilled water, but that same knowledge can apply to whether it's coconut juice or orange juice or urine. And once you are okay with drinking urine, you'll find that in the mornings you pee out about a pound of it. And so it's actually kind of the body itself offers you the whole 8 glasses a day thing if you attempt to drink your pee every time you pee.
Right.
So I find that oddly coincidental. But the overall thing is the miseducation is what's going to keep everybody from having drinking it. And I myself, as much as I know about it, I tend to drink it over sink because sometimes I have a gag reflex still, and it's from all the conditioning. If we'd all been taught this when we were in first grade and, you know, shown that it's acceptable and our parents did it, we wouldn't have that. But we are been deeply psychologically bred and damaged against it. And so I myself, sometimes halfway even through chugging it, I go, what am I doing? And I have a gag reflex, and it's uncontrollable. And so I just start over.
Yeah, but, because when you continue to drink your own urine and you're not eating any kind of cooked foods or anything like that, that your urine will actually turn into water.
Yes.
You still get a gag reflex even when it's so clear that it doesn't have an odor or a taste to it? It's still...
No, it actually comes back. It's much easier when it's like that. And, you know, I still, you know, I'm a mostly vegetarian. They call me a flexitarian. Now, if I'm going to my friend's house and they're having ribs, I'm going to eat ribs. But I'm going to pay for it the next day or morning or later that evening, my pee is going to start to have a nasty flavor in it. And that's, again, part of the whole raw food movement. Cooked food is what's creating largely the unpalatable flavor of urine. People who only eat fruit, live fruit, they literally have coconut water flavored urine. And I've had it myself when I've gone on fast to make it happen. I've personally done a 7-day fast where I didn't drink anything but my urine. And for most people, within 3 to 5 days of either drinking a gallon a day of distilled water or looping all their own urine or a gallon a day of fresh fruit juices, everybody, within 3 to 5 days, starts peeing out rainwater clear urine. And so part of what I'm trying to tell you through this talk is that distilled water or the knowledge of distilled liquids is a crutch to get you to the point where you can stand the flavor of your own urine. You don't have to deal with it when it's nasty. If you've got the willpower and discipline to cleaner to go on fruits and juices first, or just a pound of distilled water, you'll get to the rainwater clear urine state, and it's at the other end of the chart as far as being easy to drink. It actually becomes pleasurable to drink when it is clear and tastes sweet. And
right.
That's why they have babies peeing in the fountains, because it's symbolic that when you are freshly born, you are in your most cleanest state you've ever been in, and that's why babies smell sweet, and that is the state that we all have the ability to come back to. The only reason our pits stink and our feces smell is because we are full of rotting garbage. And once you clean all that out, and then you only start taking in live foods, you will have a fresh-smelling breath. You will have, believe it or not, fresh-smelling feces and fresh-smelling urine.
Well, here's another question, because I think it's really important. What if you go on, say, a 7-day fast or a 20-day fast of liquid or a 30-day fast of liquid? People talk about electrolytes and, you know, aren't you going to, like, something damaging is going to happen to you? I know you're not a doctor, but on a scientific level, maybe you can speak to that, because that might be something that I know myself, that I, when I say I want to go on a 10-day liquid fast, I get a lot of resistance. And I don't know how to counter that. I haven't taken the time to research it, so maybe you can speak to that.
Yeah. Well, I can say that myself, I've personally done 2 5-day fasts, and I went for 7 days with nothing but liquids, nothing but urine. And the other thing is all the case studies of anybody can do this themselves. And it's just, you know, sheer volume of numbers of case studies will start to help you form your opinion one way or the other. When you look at what happens to people who fast, even if they don't know about urine, and or you look into the whole urine therapy world and you see what happens to people who fast over and over again for 30 days or 100 days or, you know, or 45 days. I've read many case studies into 40, 50, 70, 100 days. And not only, like I said, do these people vaporize the problem they were trying to attack, but they lose 20 to 30 years in appearance. And their hair starts growing back, their skin looks better, their eyesight comes back. Basically, if you were to write a movie script about what you would think would happen to 4 people if they actually found the fictional fountain of youth, you know, they're getting younger and wrinkles going away and all that stuff, and gray hair turning black again, that is exactly what happens when people go on urine fasts and or distilled liquid fast, or like the girl on orange juice. So it's the distilled liquid. I guess all I can tell you is you've got to use your own intuition. You've got to sense out whether or not you think all these stories are made up or not.
And we have about 35 minutes left in the two-hour segment. So I know there's a lot more that you'd like to share with us. You have the stories about people surviving by drinking their own urine, and there's some other things about the uses, about how to use it. So so however you want to do that, you have about 35 minutes left.
Okay. That's another way to get over your fears about whether or not to fast or not. Look at survivor stories. When you Google, I did this myself because I didn't want to early on. I didn't want to make myself sick or kill myself. I Googled man gets sick from drinking urine or woman dies from drinking urine. And there's no hits out there for those stories. What the Google machine does pop up is man survives on island by drinking urine, or woman survives, you know, earthquake rubble for however long. Two men survive at sea 13 days in a boat by drinking urine. And that was one of the video. Father and daughter were trapped on an island for months, and urine is what kept them alive. Not only do people survive the survival situation where there's no other food or water available, but when they're found, they're not all decrepit and on their hands and knees at their last moment. They're just like, hey, what's up? You know, they're just like healthier than they've ever been. understand.
Yeah, and talk a little bit too about the properties of urine. What is in it? The plasma and the nutrients and all that. Like, maybe you can get a little rundown.
Every vitamin known to man is in urine. It's like a massive multivitamin. There's 2,500 plus and counting ingredients in urine. Again, it's not only is it distilled water, but it's God-made, or whatever you want to call it, distilled water. So that's why they say it's more sterile than machine-made distilled water. So just going through a human once, that water is more perfect than machine-made distilled water. Everybody, I want you to fathom in your heads what it means when somebody starts looping that same water 2 days at a time, 3 days, 10 days, 100 days, or then goes on and never takes in another additional source of water and just loops their own. How many, just going one time through the human, it's more perfect. Now imagine if it's gone looped through 100 or 1,000 times. That water starts getting just the most ultimate primo distilled water you can get. It's the fastest water there is.
But wouldn't there be less of it because they're drinking it and they're using it up? How do you make urine if you're not putting other liquids into your body?
It seems to be that the water, the whole body itself is like a condenser or an air condenser. The skin is breathing in and out all the time. You are breathing out in and out all the time, and moisture is coming in with your breath. Now, I don't know, you know, if... I mean, that's supposedly, I think my answer to how they spent 40 days and 40 nights in the desert. Nobody can carry 40 gallons of water on their back. You have your own water machine, your own distillation unit wherever you go. I mean, I don't know if, like, you know, if over 6 months in a completely dry environment, do you finally run out and you become a piece of stone yourself? I really don't. I haven't seen case studies that cover that, but I do know that people have gone for months at a time without ever taking in a new source of water, and I think it only speaks to our godliness and the perfect construction of these bodies. It means that we are meant to survive anywhere, and we don't need any particular herb from over in East Louisiana or this particular mineral that only comes from that rock up in Iceland. We are perfect creatures, and I think we could function here or at the equator of Mars or on the other side of the universe. I think this speaks to the sacred geometry and construction of these body suits that we are experiencing this reality in. What else? Oh, blood plasma. That's another thing. I mean, like I said, that's the blood is 90% water, and what I'm talking about there is blood plasma is urine. And when you draw blood out of somebody and let it settle in a tall test tube, I don't know if it takes a half an hour or what, but eventually it won't just be a red test tube. All the red particles, which are the blood platelets, will settle to the bottom, and the top entire, like 80% of the test tube, will be this yellowish clear liquid. And if you taste it, it oddly enough tastes exactly like urine.
Wow.
And they are one and the same, blood plasma and urine. And to tie that in also for this whole distilled liquids topic, and I was talking about all fruit and vegetable juices, coconut water and blood plasma are identical. So much so, it's a well-known fact, and everybody wants to look up coconuts in their history, that in World War II, in the Pacific Theater, both the Japanese and American sides, when they ran out of plasma to give to wounded soldiers, they would literally pick coconuts off trees, stick a tube in one end of the coconut, and the other end of the tube would go right into your vein. And
I'd never heard that before.
Yeah, it's got the exact...
They never had that on MASH.
yeah, right.
It's got
the exact identical electrolyte balance as your blood. And so there's just this interweaving line going in between blood and urine and coconut water and fruit juices and amniotic fluid and plasma. It's the distilled liquid aspect running straight through all those themes. Now, if distilled water is so bad for us, why is it what nature is using to operate every living being? But yet we're not supposed to drink.
What do you think they're? What do you think they're trying to keep the knowledge from us? I mean, do you have any speculations on that?
It just seems like power or greed. Mm-hmm. That's about all I can chalk it up to. Because it definitely makes us, we're all terrified of moving an inch without having a CVS drugstore on the corner down the street.
Oh, I know. And the more hospitals they build and the more medical insurance we pay for, the sicker and the more dead people become. People aren't
like
getting weller in
right.
the United States. They're getting sicker.
Fancy. They got all their gadgets and all their high-tech outfits and garbs and all this antibacterial and all these protections, and it's all a joke. We are strong, awesome, powerful creatures.
Mm-hmm.
And you can withstand any poison. And that's a survival factor.
Oh, yeah, you didn't even get into the anaphylactic effect.
Seconds after any poison enters your bloodstream, the antidote is in your urine. Whether it's, like I said, a black mamba or a coral snake or a tarantula or a black widow, all you have to do is pee out into your hands, you know, about 15 seconds after you get bit, and the antidote is in your pee. How that works is, the kidneys allow homeopathic-sized dots of everything that's good and bad with you into the urine. And for those not familiar with homeopathy, basically it works by giving you infinitesimally small dots of a particular thing, and it gives you a healing reaction, a massive, the smaller the dot, it seems to be the more massive the corrective reaction is. And in homeopathy, if you are stung by a bee and you're having an anaphylactic shock reaction, you look up and it'll say to take Apis, which is bee poison. And they're telling you to take bee poison to counter-react the reaction from bee poison. You're like, wait, that doesn't make any sense. It just seems to work that way in nature, that whereas a large amount of something will create a poisonous reaction and death, an infinitesimally small amount of it will create the opposite reaction. And that is, seems to be how the kidneys are also working. It will allow homeopathic-sized dots of the snake venom into your urine, and all you have to do is hold it under your tongue, and the two giant lymph nodes under your tongue are those are the guys that make antibodies. And the homeopathic-sized dots of the snake venom in your urine is called antigens. And when you hold your urine under your tongue, those two lymph nodes get to study the antigens. And they go, ah, this is the guy that's messing with us. And bam, bam, bam. Okay, start making the correct antibodies, because now we know who it is. And I've read testimonial after testimonial about people dealing with snake and spider bites that same way. Everybody right now is terrified that that's going to be the end. If you're out in the woods, you get whacked by a rattlesnake or a cobra or water moccasin, that you're dead unless you get to the hospital within 15 minutes. And that's usually true if you don't know that you're a perfect machine and you've got all your defenses. My own personal case study with that is my father and I are both allergic to walnuts, and we could tell you if somebody had put walnuts in cookies, because we both started getting cankers in our mouth. And urine will not only stop the reaction in real time, but you can use it to permanently educate your body to never have the reaction in the first place. And just by my continual drinking of urine over the years, I no longer react to walnuts at all. And I never purposely tried to erase it. It's just my body kept giving me the antigens of the walnut, and it educated my body not to have that stupid reaction in the first place. And by the way, the majority of allergic reactions, like people have these crazy allergies to peanuts and all kinds of silly things, fluoride is responsible for that, especially the glucose allergy, you know, this whole gluten-free aisles in the health food stores. That is, again, a result of ripped DNA, and the body's not functioning right. So that can restore, from the overall path, too, of letting the body restore from distilled liquids. But through urine therapy, if somebody's having a reaction, you know, their chest is swelling up, starting to breathe, just give them a little bit of pee, and you would normally think that it's only their pee would do it, but as our minds have all expanded here, we realize that we're all oneness. You can be a stranger in a crowd and walk by somebody that's having an allergic reaction to peanuts, and you could pee out a little bit of your pee and give it to them. The vibes of, you know, homeopathy work is on intestinally small dots, well, including vibrations, and the vibration of that person having that reaction is going to be in anybody else's pee as well. And I've seen case studies where it's worked that way. It would have sounded crazy to me, too, back when I was in the 70s or 80s, but as I started to learn more that the hidden senses are real and that there's much more to this world than the five senses, you start to be able to allow for this kind of information. And it works when you try it. So it proves it to you, even if you're a Western-raised kid. My own personal story with the wasp, though, the walnuts is one thing, but my father and I are also both deathly allergic to wasp stings, and we have to carry around an EpiPen with us in case we go into anaphylactic shock. And the last time I got stung before I knew about urine, I was minutes away from dying. I got rushed to a hospital, and there was a, you know, if you had a broken thumb, it looked like you had been in the waiting room for 5 hours waiting. It was so packed with people. But I went in there and told them I was having an anaphylactic shock, and they said, okay, give me your name and sit down. I wasn't sitting down for more than 5 seconds before they called me, and they had five doctors and nurses all around me giving me liquid IV, liquid Benadryl, oxygen to my face, taking my blood pressure, and calming me down manually. And so they saved my life and prescribed me an EpiPen. But just a year or so ago, I got stung by a wasp, and I thought, oh, man, here's my own personal chance to see if this works. And my friend who had actually driven me to the hospital before was actually right there with me, and I peed into my hand about 15 seconds later and just put, you know, that little bit. It might have not been more than 10 or 20 drops under my tongue. And I sat down at the kitchen table with the car keys in one hand and the EpiPen in the other, and I waited and to see what would happen. And 10 minutes went by, and then 20 minutes, and then 40 minutes, and my body was completely silent. There was absolutely no reaction to the wasp sting, whereas the last time, my whole body started itching, my head started tingling, and my chest started getting tighter and tighter and tighter. And this time, nothing happened. And the most I felt was 3 days later, I felt a slight itching sensation where the wound had actually, where I'd been stung. And so I feel like I can honestly say to everybody that I used it to stop that anaphylactic reaction, and again, it worked exactly the way all the books said it would work.
And there's no doubt that you were stung by a wasp.
Yeah, I uncovered a whole... I was actually working in the same yard where I'd been stung before, and I was moving a log, and a whole swarm of wasps came up, and they were unmistakable.
Oh, my.
It's
great testimony.
Yeah.
We have about 20 minutes left, and I'm trying to think what you forgot to talk about. I guess... We can go back to
I know
what
I'm talking about, the detox. People start doing this.
Right.
If you start doing the gallon a day thing of distilled water, or you start pounding your own urine, you know, there's some people this resonates with, they're just going to go for it because they're tired of being screwed over and they want results and they want to get better, and so some people are going to jump into it. If you do, be forewarned that this stuff does not mess around. When I tell you that this is the greatest solvent known to the human body, listen to what that means. you are going to start having the smelliest armpits you've ever had. Your feces is going to smell more foul than you could ever imagine. Your breath is going to get disgusting. And what that is that solvent is dissolving the decades-old crap that's inside you. And it depends on where the crap is. It'll come out in different places for different people. I know a friend of mine, she has breast cancer in her family history. And when she started doing this, lo and behold, and at 50 years old, she started getting sores on her breast. And so I think she, right then and there, in those few weeks of pounding distilled water, ejected future breast cancer. A lot of people start having feces that smells heavily of petroleum. And you're like, what is that? And it's all the plastic, petroleum, all the saran wrap our food's been wrapped in, all the times that mom microwaved our food with saran wrap over it, all the oil fumes we breathed in, all the gasoline fumes filling up, being in traffic, all this stuff is just holding and collecting inside us, and it's got to come out, and better out than in, right? And it doesn't last for long, but the detox reactions can be vomiting, diarrhea, rashes, flu-like symptoms, nausea. But know this, everybody. The body does not make mistakes. It is we, the captain of the ship, that can make mistakes in its guidance. If you give the body the chance to clean out and to reverse all this damage, it will take serious advantage of that. And on average, it seems like when somebody stops eating for one day, they lose about a year's worth of the destruction from eating. So hence, people go on a 20 to 30 day fast, on average, don't take my word for it, look it up yourself, they lose 20 to 30 years in appearance. Now, of course, if you're 40, you can't lose 30 years in appearance. You're not going to become a 10-year-old child. But in general, the most people, they get reduced down to their 29, 25-year-old, bright, vibrant version of themselves. And what all this research is showing is that we all have that ability to live in that state forever. I don't care if it's 150 years, 200 years, or 3,000 years. So far, Western science does not have one single reason for us to die. All the most they can come up with for aging is toxic overload. And that is what urine therapy and these case studies show you, is that when you allow the body the chance, it will reverse it. The fountain of youth is a real thing and has the ability to really do that. An important part to that is Dr. Alexis Carrel wrote a book called Man, the Unknown. And one of the things he did was take a bunch of earthworms and give them their regular diet. But every once in a while, this one particular earthworm, he would pull out from the pack and he would fast it for a week. Or, you know, a little bit of time. And he kept doing that periodically with that one same earthworm. That earthworm outlived 19 generations of its peers. If that had been a human, that would have been a 2,000-year-old man.
That's amazing.
Yeah. Okay, so this will clean you out. You will have detox reactions. This will allow your body to start functioning normally as you've always wanted it to. Another thing this will, like, the reason that the Egyptian papyrus says that it will reveal the hidden senses, it will reveal to us something we've all never experienced. When you're born when you're a baby, all of your glands, all of your senses, your hidden, your sixth, seventh, eighth hidden senses, they're all functioning and alive. But you're not an adult. You're a baby. And so by the time you're an adult, your whole system's been shut down with mud, tar, and grease, and you don't have those delicate faculties alive and picking up all those perceptions. What you want to get to is the baby-like state in an adult body. And that's what this is the path to. But be forewarned, again, of the detox reaction. Don't let it fool you that you're getting sick. The body doesn't make mistakes. You give it the chance to eject garbage, and it is going to shovel the garbage out of you. Um, Sometimes you can't get to the toilet fast enough, so just be forewarned. But it's all good things, and it's all temporary.
Now, if you suppose you've done this fast, like you've done a 10-day liquid fast or maybe even a 20-day liquid fast, you also talked about in the video other things that you can do with the detoxing, with enema and other ways to use the urine for your body. And if you could just go over that again, I think we have about 14 minutes left.
Okay. Two major things, aside from drinking it, that's the internal rinse, and you can visualize that cleaning you up from the inside. And let's make sure we don't forget about the Merkaba before we're done with this and ascension.
Okay.
The other two main ways to use it to cleanse the body are the external rubbing and massaging of it and or enemas. And I believe, you know, mainly my case studies have been with urine, but I don't see any reason why you couldn't use distilled water to rub your skin with and to use for enemas. Basically what that's doing is it's assisting in washing away the detox reactions. Distilled water dissolves mineral deposits. And so as that junk starts to come out of you, as you saturate the body, you take in nothing but distilled liquid for days on end, that's the key, is to let it just keep staying saturated. Those decades-long deposits will eventually soften up and start to fall out of you. And when they do, in all the urine therapy books, they recommend taking a bath in it once a day and or do an enema. And the enema is coming at you from the other end of the alimentary canal. Your mouth, you dump it in, you drink it when it's fresh. That's coming in one end. You do enemas, and that's your biggest sewer pipe. And you'll notice in a lot of the books, let's say you've got lung cancer, and you look, okay, what do I do to start with urine therapy? And it'll say, first thing, do an enema. And you go, wait a second, I'm talking about my lungs, not the other end there. And what it's trying to get you to do is to clean out your biggest sewer pipe. And they talk about people having compacted matter in the folds of the large intestines. All that stuff is blocking you up. And if you do an enema and let distilled water or urine sit in there, it will start to dissolve and loosen the compacted matter from the folds of your large intestine. And I've had black circular chunks and rings fall out of me, strange looking things. It doesn't look like feces at all. But you go, aha, finally this stuff is coming out of me. And if the biggest sewer pipe gets cleansed out, all of the other smaller and smaller and smaller sewer pipes that are above it, they can start falling and dumping into it. And so it sets off a chain reaction. You got lung cancer, you're clogged up there, you let the biggest sewer pipe empty out, then all the sewer pipes connected and leading up to the lungs can start dumping out. And it just gets the whole system cleansed out.
Okay, and how about the medicinal effects, burns and things like that?
Yes. In Japanese and ancient and Asian families that know about this, they on average will keep 30 to 40 gallons of aged urine on hand for emergencies. And say a little boy pulls a pot of boiling water off the stove and burns his whole body, they will immediately wrap him up and take those 30, 40 gallons and keep his whole body, those bandages, soaked in aged urine. And that's a whole other aspect of urine therapy, is this thing of aging it, and only for external use, though. If you've ever found urine that somebody left in the toilet and it stinks to high hell, that is the aging process going on, and all that's really happening is the miracle massive multivitamin formula is still there, but the uric acid has fermented into ammonia, and the ammonia content of it has shot through the roof, and that's what's creating that incredible stench. But what the ammonia does is it quote-unquote makes it softer, and it penetrates super deep into your skin. And this will allow burns and serious gashes, wounds of all type, to heal with no scars. And you're completely used to burn victims just, you know, well, that's it. They're scarred for life. When burn victims are treated with aged urine, they heal with no scars. And that's, remember, go back to the baby, and mm-hmm. that whatever urine touches returns it to its original genetic DNA instructions. And aged urine becomes like 100 to 1,000 times more, exponentially more powerful when you age it. It just really, really destroys anything you that's not you, and really, really helps to create what is supposed to be you, especially when you have deep wounds or gashes. It just builds you and stitches that skin up, just like there's, you know, somebody in there with Legos putting you all back together. You take off.
I can attest to that, because I had sunburn in Ecuador, and I had a terrible sunburn. I think the pictures are on my Facebook page in my picture section, and I used urine for about 2 days, and I not only didn't peel, which I always burn and peel, I'm very fair-skinned, but I had the beautifulest tan for the longest time I've ever had in my life. It was amazing, the healing that I got from using urine, and just, like, I would say 36 hours of using it continuously throughout that 36-hour period, that I was almost completely healed, and I didn't peel or anything. I think I had, like, second-degree burns from doing a therapy meditation out in the sun. But we have about 6 minutes left, or, I'm sorry, 8 minutes left, and you just intrigued me beyond measure talking about the Merkaba.
Oh.
And I don't even know why you brought that up, but you have to talk about that.
Okay. For those interested in ascension and who have been studying the Merkaba, and we're all familiar, we've been seeing these terms that when the chariots of the gods, there were these spinning wheels of light, keep hearing reference to spinning wheels of energy or light. When you, and this only works with urine, not distilled water or rainwater or fruit juices. If time is lateral and all time is happening at once, all events, past, present, future, happening at once, visualize yourself drinking your urine once, twice, three times, 100 times, 1,000 times. Imagine having it all at once. And now see visually in your mind, the water goes down through your body and comes back out your fountain, into a glass, back up into your body, down through the body, into a glass, up to your mouth, down through your body, into the glass, up to your mouth, over, over and over. What have you created? You've created a spinning wheel of energy. And that triggers your Merkaba to fire up. And for those that continually drink their urine, they will keep their Merkaba on. And that is a prerequisite to ascending.
And where did you get this information?
Magenta Pixie 2012. She's got an excellent.
She's familiar.
She's got a YouTube channel. Again, that's Magenta Pixie 2012. I don't know her at all, but I once found a video of hers who's talking. It was called Urine Therapy and Ascension. And when she said that, I could just instantly visualize it. And for me, it goes hand in hand. That would make sense. That everything is simple. Again, everybody, come back to simplicity. We have all these powers, and it's been told, oh, you got to, you know, to be a doctor, you got to study for 12 years. To be a meditator, you got to study for 15, 20 years before you can even hope to have a glimpse of anything. It's all bullshit. We all have the ability. We all have our powers. We are all gods, and acquiring water, which everybody's freaked out about, is right in your body. You've got your own water maker, and everybody's spending all this money buying expensive water, and everybody wants to get their third eye open. They want to astral travel. It's as simple, again, as closing your eyes. Your water source is as simple as drinking your own water. And firing up your Merkaba is as simple as drinking your own water, the water of life.
So well, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Well, we have 5 minutes left, and I'm sure when I hang up, I'm going to think of something, but we can always have you come back, and you can wow us again with more stuff. But is there anything that you would like to say before we close?
Just for those that are listening that might, if we do happen to get a speech going in Sarasota, to tune in to Chrissy for when that might be and if that's going to happen.
Yes, we're looking into, we have a community center here, and I'm going to call them tomorrow morning. But if worse comes to worse, I have a personal venue that we can use, and I'm not sure if I emailed you about that. But we have seating for about 20. If it gets bigger than that, I don't. There's going to be standing room only. But
I do have this one thing I think would be great to end it with. If anybody looks on Amazon for a book called The Distilled Water Cure, there's one copy of it available for $27. It's used. But it comes from the Mazdaznan Association. That's Mazdaznan. And this guy that died in 1936 wrote this book. It's only 16 pages long, but it's called The Distilled Water Cure. And I have a copy of it right here. And he's got this great line in here, which it says, the great advantage of the water cure is that one need ask no question. One just takes it, and everything comes lay itself, so long as one resorts there too. As a result of the water cure, and here it is, one begins to think for oneself instead of asking questions. One becomes a thinking human being. So what this means is all of your own hidden senses open up. If we never hear from each other again, we all have the knowledge to become our own complete encyclopedia. If you want to access the Akashic records, if those are real, if you want to talk to your higher self, if you've got a question about what the heck is going on, why is life so screwed up, this one simple piece of knowledge about running pure water through your own body will lead you to a state where you don't need to ask anybody else any questions. You don't need Chrissy and Andrew doing a radio show. We will all know exactly what we need to do. And again, for me, it resonates because it's simple and it makes sense that we have all the powers that we need to right within the own body suit that we are here operating in. So that one begins
beautiful.
To think for oneself. Is that not what we could all use?
Yes. Yes. And we have like a minute and a half left, and I just want to reaffirm that Andrew's given us a lot of links. And I've also linked the video that I made of him. I'm still subtitling the middle part, but the beginning and the end is available on YouTube at Babcha Means Love, all one word. But the link is on the this site for his interview. And this interview will remain in archives for anyone who wants to share it or listen to it again. Thank you, Andrew. I'm so grateful that I got to meet you and hear about this awesome information and just going through this.
Blog Talk Radio.
Good evening. Buenas noches and greetings to everyone for joining me on my first two-hour Babcha's Pearls Blog Talk Radio Show. Up. Music doesn't want to stop. We have that frequently. Okay. I'm Chrissy McMahon, your host on this pleasant Sarasota evening. It's 57 degrees. The moon is waxing at 28% full, and the sun is quiet. I want to start the show by acknowledging the Tucson, Arizona Congresswoman Gabrielle Giffords and her critical injuries and the others who were killed. I would like to ask that everyone listening send their healing light and forgiveness to those involved and affected by this tragedy. Only love heals. Thank you all for your continued good intentions, and love is greatly needed, and it works miracles. And I would now like to give you a brief rundown on what I've been following in my last show concerning the mass deaths of the birds, fish, tortoise, crabs, and doves reported on the mainstream media continue to suspect poison, although no autopsies have concluded chemical, biological agents are involved, only massive internal injuries. And I recently learned about a personal numerology that the year 2011 is a number 4 year, and according to Marcia Bender, Spiritually Speaking column in the New Florida Sun Coast Transformations magazine, which is free in the West Florida area, she writes, personal years show how to avoid trouble, direct personal affairs, and get the best from experiences. You can check out her website at metaphysicswithmarcia.com. That's one word, metaphysicswithmarcia.com. And you can check out numerology on that link. And tonight, without further ado, we have a very special guest for this two-hour format. Tonight, my special guest is Andrew Norton Webber, an artist who I met in Vilcabamba, Ecuador, at the 1020 Newtopia 2010 conference, where he discussed distilled liquids and their effect on organic creatures. And tonight, he is going to give a brief presentation about what he's learned about distilled liquids and their effect on our health. And I believe that this information is so important that I'm asking that everybody share this information. I've posted it on my Facebook at Chrissy McMahon at Facebook, and I'm posting all the links that he's sending me here on this link to Blog Talk Radio, Babcha's Pearls, for his archive will be available here anytime to review. So I'm going to ask Andrew now to give us a brief bio about himself, and he can start his conversation whenever he's ready. Andrew, are you there?
Yeah, Chrissy, how you doing?
Hi, I'm going to take you off speaker. Hold on.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Hey, thanks for having me on. Like you, I want to send out this message with love to everybody. My name is Andrew Norton Webber, and I was born in Maine, 1970, and grew up there with a typical Western education. And somewhere along the way, I started making art, and I've continued to do that. And my artworks, found object sculptures, can be viewed at AndrewNortonWebber.com, and Webber is with two B's. I guess we should get right to it. I was responsible for feeding my family 5 or 6 years ago, and somehow started learning about all the poisons that were surrounding us, fluoride in the water and additives in the food, and noticing how decrepit our fellow citizens had become, and noticing that my great-grandparents and grandparents all lived to much older ages with many more of their faculties intact, and just within my own growing up, watch people get more and more decrepit at earlier and earlier ages. And so I started looking into how I could best protect my family from health and feeding them and the right liquids until, of course, water was high on the list.
I think that's an excellent start. Keep going. I'm sorry to interrupt.
I at first was fooled by most people away from distilled water. There was a theme out there that it would leach minerals from the body, and it was visually you were given the description that say it would leach the calcium out of your bones, and you would fall apart literally and crumple to the floor. And there just seemed to be this back and forth banter about it, but no real way for me to know whether it was true or not. So I couldn't really take a risk on poisoning my family. And from my study at the time, I thought that mountain spring water was the best that there was, and then spring water was second best, and then, well water below that. And it turns out after much research that it's almost completely the opposite. The more time that water has run through rocks, say all the way through a mountain, the more chance it's had to pick up material that is actually very largely responsible for a lot of the decay we see, aside from the man-made ingested chemicals like fluoride and aspartame. It turns out that distilled liquids are the only liquids that actually remove things from the body. Pure water has nothing attached to it, has no dirt to it. It's distilled water is water that's been taken apart and reassembled bit by bit. You would think that when you looked up in the dictionary, you'd see steam evaporation as the main definition, but that's only per example. It's any number of ways that water is completely separated at the molecular level, and when it's reassembled as just pure hydrogen and oxygen, that's distilled water, and that's it is the greatest solvent known to the human body. And yes, you could pour other solvents on your body and literally dissolve the body, like hydrochloric acid. But that's not what I'm talking about. This particular solvent dissolves everything except you. And it makes simple sense once you come back to it that we are water-based creatures, and you would use water to clean us up. When you use oil-based cleaners, oil-based paints, you use oil-based cleaners. And when you use water-based paints, you use water-based creatures. And so this simple answer really comes back to that pure water, which is only one form of it, and that's distilled water, is the solvent that we all need to turn around this massive degeneration that we've witnessed amongst all of our loved ones. And we're all very scared and confused and don't know where to begin. And everything seems scientific, and Western medicine is just full of all these high-tech gadgetry images and gadgets. And, they've got urine up on the International Space Station, but you need $1 million machine to turn it into drinkable water. They're always putting out this front that access to high health is only available if you have lots of money and lots of technology. And what I'm going to reveal to you during this talk, hopefully, is that once again, the answers come back to simplicity, and we are supposed to be made perfect, and that's what these answers are pointing to, is that we don't need fancy machines. We are perfect as we are, and all the answers lie within us.
That's a beautiful statement, Andrew, and I think that's a beautiful beginning for this conversation. Before we go any further, I would just like to encourage people, if they have any questions, they can either call in live at 347-637-1832 or they can ask their questions through chat, which is open live now. And I'm switching back and forth so I can keep abreast of anybody who might like to do that. But maybe you need to give them a little bit more information. So I just wanted to encourage people to call in. The number is 347-637-1832. And Andrew loves questions, so don't be bashful. Okay, go ahead, Andrew.
Yeah, your questions help define what I've left out and what people need to know. So please, any questions at any time.
Certainly. Thank you.
Let's kind of start with where we are right now in time. We're all holding our breath. We've got this 2012 drumbeat over our heads, and the main media just pumps out nothing but fear about it. And I found in my studies that whatever they're promoting, you generally should run in the opposite direction, and whatever they're telling you to stay away from is usually some of the best things that there are. And so that, just for one thing, makes me actually optimistic towards 2012, and life has been full of more and more coincidental happenings lately that encourage that for myself on a whole personal level. We're at this, the age of Aquarius is supposed to be upon us, and it's supposed to be the end of the age of Pisces. And there's a lot of talk that this is the lowest point on the great year, the lowest point of our mental awareness, of our vibrational state. And I find it interesting that Aquarius, the water bearer, is who shows up at this time on the wheel, because what better way to start off a rise towards a new Atlantis, or whatever it may turn out to be, than a good cleanup job. And that is exactly what the information of pure water is going to do for us. This seems to be just, almost everywhere you look, it's a nightmare of people and messages and the shape that people in and the mentality of people. And people are very disconcerted and confused and disoriented. And something as simple as pure water is going to be where we need to start. So I appreciate Aquarius showing up. I think the age of Pisces is finally over, and let us rejoice in the age of Aquarius, a new beginning and a new chance to create the new dimension. There's also talk that water is the lubricant between dimensions. I don't know if you ever heard that before. And that
no,
also
I don't think I have.
Yeah, I heard Leonard Horowitz talking about that, and I've seen it a couple of other places. And that rang with me as well, again, about this Pisces-Aquarius split, because this is supposed to be a time when we make a shift to a new dimension or a new vibrational rate. And what do we have showing up? Water. And water is the lubricant between dimensions. So here we go. Whether it's all just coincidental or not, it makes for good poetry.
Yeah.
So we'll go with that.
And you're speaking so eloquently. I'm just so honored. This is amazing. But wait till you get to the real meat of what you're trying to say here. This is just absolutely wonderful. Thank you, Andrew. I'm very honored that you're taking the time to share this with us. So I don't want to keep interrupting, but I'm just in awe. Go ahead. Thank you.
And thank you too for you filmed this me down in Ecuador, and you are likewise having the courage to speak out and put this out there, and it's resonating with you, and so it's making you feel comfortable. It's resonating with me, so it's making me feel comfortable to speak, and I hope everybody else can feel this as we relay this information.
Yes, I believe there's an opening for this now. People are very interested. We have about 10 people on chat, so I'm pretty excited. I hope they'll have the courage, too, to ask questions.
Okay.
So
let's get right to where people can get distilled water. And how it works. So give the proof for it as well. There's four main types of distilled water. There's machine-made distilled water, all fruit and vegetable juices, urine, and rainwater. The second half of a rainstorm, it's all distilled water, but the first half generally clears the skies and it becomes undistilled by the time it falls. And the second half is distilled water, although I'm not sure with the chemtrails now what state it's in when it finally reaches the ground. So that's where you can get them, but let me more define distilled. It took me a while to figure out what they were talking about, and if you put the link up to Dr. Handley's paper on your radio page there, he made the point about that distilled water is the most molecularly unstable water there is. And when he said that, it finally clicked for me what distilled means. It's unstilled, meaning it used to be still, and now it's not still. And so when I say it's the fastest water there is, I'm kind of relating it to surface tension. And like the Dead Sea, you can float, it's so full of other objects besides hydrogen and oxygen, you can float a concrete canoe on it. And so it has incredibly high surface tension. It's, I think distilled water probably has the lowest surface tension. And that's what they mean by it's molecularly unstable. It doesn't have all these different little particles attached to it. And so when you drink it into your body, it goes everywhere with no resistance because there's no little parts to it making it scratchier and slow down and have a lot of texture and friction. And you'll find that if you haven't ever drank distilled water, if you quickly put down a pound of it, 16 ounces, you'll feel something akin to a hot flash or some internal heat, or some people feel literally a bead of sweat on their back and front. And we all know that when we sweat, that's a detox reaction. And what that is showing you is how fast that this water cuts through you. So I'll get back to more about the hot flash later. People have to know whether or not they can drink it, first of all, because when you do look it up, you'll run into the same thing that fooled me 5 or 6 years ago, which is, oh gosh, it might leach minerals from the body. Well, this is an on-purpose fake science campaign to keep you away from it because it's so simple. And this knowledge is worth trillions of dollars and massive amounts of power if you keep it away from people. And so there are these incomplete arguments out there, like the WHO, if you look up them in distilled water, and even most people, when you ask them what do they know about distilled water, they'll generally say, oh, no, don't, because it'll leach minerals from the body. And where they're largely getting that from is the WHO's paper that says plainly, do not drink distilled water because it will leach minerals from the body. And a couple of sentences later, they throw in, and by the way, you should add fluoride to your water as well. So if anybody is hip to how poisonous sodium fluoride is, you know where that paper is coming from. It doesn't make sense. It's who would recommend fluoride. You should be suspicious of them telling you not to drink distilled water. But still, you don't have any proof. It just says that. And what they're leaving out is that it's scientifically known that there's two types of minerals. There's organic and inorganic. And so when they just say, don't drink it because it leaches minerals from the body, they're forgetting to clarify what types of minerals they're talking about. And you might say, oh, maybe they're talking about both minerals. Well, there is proof for that, and there is a proof to forever put that question to rest. Let me just state it, first of all, though, that distilled water only leaches inorganic minerals from the body. And this is a scientifically known fact, and this supposedly great scientific body, the World Health Organization, that's supposed to be the pinnacle of watching out for our health, somehow overlooks the fact that they need to distinguish what minerals it actually leaches from the body. Because yes, you can say, yes, it's true, it does leach minerals from the body, but only inorganic ones should be added to that sentence. It does not leach organic minerals. And what's the purpose of that distinction? Very, very big purpose for that distinction, is that the human body is only made out of organic minerals. There is zero position and or zero use for inorganic minerals in the body. So sodium fluoride, just for starters, is an inorganic mineral. What's it doing in our drinking water, let alone how poisonous it is? Just the fact that it's inorganic says that it has no use to the body. The body does not create life out of dead matter. The body only uses life to create more life. And so I am in a rare position to have the proof to argue about distilled water because of having studied the whole world of urine therapy for 5 years. That was something I learned early on. A yogi that I was talking to, I was peppering him like a human Google machine, trying to figure out how to save my family, asking about everything, the herbs, the gems, and raw food, and on and on and on, and I was out of questions, and at the end of it, he finally goes, you know, you can drink your urine and cure just about anything. And I was like, what? And he goes, yeah, look up urine therapy. And that term right there, if anybody wants to start their own search, that's what you punch into either Amazon or Google. And it's all right there. But if you never know to search for it, you'll never find it. I have personally collected from all over the planet over 20 books on urine therapy. And they're from Australia, Germany, India, England, America. I know there's Japanese and Asian books. I just have never bought one. But they're all very small, and because the instructions are pretty simple. You drink it fresh, and only when it's fresh, and you bathe in it once a day. And if you're really sick and you're trying to reverse any disease, you go on a fast of just urine. And what you start to notice over and over again when you read all these case studies, and I've personally read and learned about over 1,000 of them. Each book might contain about 50 of them, but then there's just, you know, the numerous people I've talked to over the years, my own experiences, other people have tried it because I told them to, and they report back to me what happened. Without fail, over and over and over again, when people go on a 20 or 30 day urine fast, they lose 20 to 30 years of appearance. Not only do they vaporize cancer, tuberculosis, AIDS, leprosy, whatever you want to name it, it vaporizes that, but then reverses the body's age. And urine, like I said, is one of the four sources of distilled water. It is a well-known fact that urine is 95% water, and it's not just any kind of water, it's distilled water. And so the entire world of case histories of urine therapy can be used to prove to people that distilled water only leaches inorganic minerals from the body. A couple of very strong cases in point are arthritis and the whitening of the teeth. It is well known and documented throughout all these books that the application of urine compacts or compresses and or massages on the skin, and combined with drinking it, melts arthritis. And the same thing when people swish for 10 minutes at a time with urine, in a pretty quick amount of time, very shortly, their teeth start turning white. And you will see this over and over and over again in all the urine therapy books. And when I first read that, I was like, wow, that's phenomenal. I can't believe it. And I can't believe it because I'm also witnessing it in my fellow friends and in my own teeth. I'm an artist, so I know what color it looks like, and I've watched my teeth go from kind of yellow to less yellow, and they get whiter by the day. And none of the books that I had, part of what we're talking about here is a kind of a revelation that I've had from putting all these bodies of information together. None of them explained how urine was doing these amazing things, but yet you knew it was because there were so many testimonials from all over the planet, and you see it in your own experiments. And the most I could figure out, even over 5 years, I think it's why I bought 20 books, is I kept trying to figure out how. And as I tried to tell people about it, they kept asking me, yeah, but why, how, isn't the waste product, on. And it really forced me to come up with answers if I was going to actually try to tell people about it.
Yeah, Andrew, before you get into the how, I would really like you to talk more about the gestation part. I think it's real important for people to understand that how we start life. And there's a couple other things. If you could explain that, and maybe that will help people understand. We have this cultural, repulsion to any talk about urine as anything besides a waste product.
Gotcha.
And maybe you can get more into the mechanics of how that works, too, before you, tell them, how to use it. Do you understand? Because I know that I've come up against the same resistance with people when I've tried to talk to them about the importance of urine therapy and how beneficial it is. But, sometimes I guess I lead with the foot. I tell them the end of the story and don't tell them the beginning of it. And I think it might help culturally to understand where we come from. How do we start our lives and how that the mechanics of the distillation process, how that works.
Okay. Just to make sure you prompt me to come back to the teeth, because that's the proof of and our
certainly.
Credit. But, yeah, you're right. Explain it. We've actually all floated in urine for 9 months. We'll help people to understand where this is coming from.
Mm-hmm.
What you were referring to, the beginning of life, is the amniotic fluid is 95% urine, I don't know, 5% goo. But for the most part, for the first 3 months, it's your mom's urine, and for the remaining 6 months, it's your urine. And I use this to not only help people see that it creates life, but that it's also not a waste product. Because if it were a waste product, how is it possible that a fetus, even the a zygote, from day one is floating in urine? And if it was a waste product, we wouldn't be growing in it for much more than a couple of days. This is why they say that the water breaks, and urine is in truth is known as the water of life. And anywhere you see it in the Bible where they're talking about rivers of living water or the water of life, if you read that understanding that they're talking about urine, the statements make a lot more sense, and you understand that's why it is. And this is why babies and angels are always peeing into fountains, because it is that very pee that you pee out while you're inside your mother that grows yourself. People keep coming back to, yeah, but isn't urine a waste product? And look at the baby. Look at where the waste cord is attached to the baby. The umbilical cord is attached to the intestines. Is there an umbilical cord covering your genitals and capturing your pee? No. It's your pee that's actually creating the water that breaks, the water of life. If you were going to grow a human in a floating solution, I would think the liquid you would be on top of your list to choose would be one called the water of life. And we breathe it in. We float in it for 9 months. That's why babies have such awesome plump skin when we come out, because they've been floating in urine for 9 months. And it's supermodel's biggest secret, that they put fresh urine on their face at night and then wash it off in the morning. It makes the skin super soft and supple. And as you're floating in mom, we breathe like a fish at that point, if you all remember. And what is it that you're breathing in? You're breathing in urine. And without it, our lungs would not form. It's basically the ultimate human growth medium. And whatever you touch it to restores it to its original genetic DNA instructions.
That's perfect. And then the mechanics of how urine, the distillation product process in our bodies.
Okay.
How that, the nephrons that you talked
right.
about in the video that I have. Maybe you could explain that. I think
yeah.
that's really important because I actually checked because I was trying to find the words. But I went and I researched what you were talking about, and the picture, if you can go online and Google it and see the picture of what a nephron is, maybe you can explain how the kidney works and the plasma and all that, you know, I think that's real important. That's the part I left out when I talked about it the other day because I think that's so important to say, where does urine really come from? What's the mechanics of it?
Okay.
You know, we can tout the benefits and how to use it, but... Really, we really need to understand so we can get that mental picture of it being a waste product into what it actually is. We need to understand
okay.
where it comes from and what it actually is.
So one, we've got the babies floating in. So that helps to argue against it being a waste product and we form in it. The mechanics of it more to help you understand it's not a waste product. The overall misconception that people have is that the liver handles solid waste and the kidneys handle liquid waste. And it's absolutely not true. The liver handles all waste. And when blood leaves the liver, it is completely clean and needs no more cleaning. When the blood enters the kidneys, even CRC Publishing is a very well-respected scientific journal. Their book on urinalysis states that blood leaving the kidney is only very slightly altered compared to blood entering the kidney. And so if those were cleaners, it would be greatly altered, not only very slightly altered. And it looks like there's a couple of basic functions to the kidneys rather than being cleaners and blood filters. One is pressure released, and that's the most that I'll allow people to argue that it's a waste product. Say, like when you drink a lot of beer, you start having to pee a lot. Well, your kidneys are responsible literally for your internal blood pressure, and so when you got too much liquid in there, it has to release it. The other one is your pH balance. Like a medicine chest, your kidneys are pulling out and removing and inserting back into the blood to make it the proper pH balance for what you need at that time. And as far as the nephrons, when I referred to the dictionary and distillation, and you might think it says steam evaporation, but no, that's only per example. What it really says is bit by bit. And that's, I say that because you know that there's no steam evaporators inside your kidneys.
Right.
And so that is another example of distillation. The water is being distilled. It's being made to flow as smoothly as possible. There are a million nephrons inside each kidney. And when you look at an individual nephron, it's got this set of loops in it, which are called the distal tubules, distillation tubes. And every nephron has one of those. So inside your body, you have 2 million distillation tubes. And they are squeezing the water finer and finer and finer. And the end of each nephron comes down to, people generally think that their kidneys are solid, but there's actually a cave, a chamber, in the middle of each kidney. And kind of like water weeps through the inside wall of a cave, that mm-hmm. interior chamber in the middle of your kidney, brand new, what eventually is called urine, weeps from that wall. And that is where that water is coming back together bit by bit. And from there, from the bottom of each one of those two chambers, there's a tube which leads to the bladder. And so your body is actually distilling water, and it's how...
some information and just going through this interview, I feel like I am accomplishing my goal here as a human being, that this is my purpose, and I'm so grateful that that you are helping me to fulfill that by sharing this wonderful information.
Thank you for being a medium to also help it happen. I think we are all, whoever's listening, we are all the water barriers, and let us bear this knowledge to ourselves and to our fellow man who have forgotten it. The time to remember it is now, and it's here now.
Well, thank you, Andrew. And you can check out his art at what's the name of your website?
Andrew Norton Webber. It's AndrewNortonWebber.com.
Okay, and all the links plus the ones that you sent me, I'm going to put on. I tried to do it while we were speaking, but it knocked the chat off. And I want to thank all the people who came to the chat and had the courage to listen, but maybe not ask questions. I hope they'll feel free to email me or email Andrew if you have any more questions, and we could get a follow-up. There's actually a phone call. We only have like 30 seconds. Go ahead, ask your question.
Just want to say hi to Andrew.
Hey, Dad.
How are you, kid?
Pretty good.
Wow, you are if you'll pardon the expression, a well of knowledge on this subject. Ooh.
Thank you, Father. That means so much to me. You are so funny.
Oh, well, yeah. There are a few who believe that.
That's
all right.
Like Father, like Son.
Uh-oh.
Namaste, gentlemen. Thank you so much.
All right.
God Bye-bye. Bless you and love always. Thank you. Bye-bye.
God bless.
Bye-bye.
Did I hear that?
Yep. It's on the tape. Bye-bye.
Bye. I'll call you in a bit, Dad.